Voice of Philippines.
And we are ANC. Michelle Long, it's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 11 a.m. in Sydney. The headlines: Asian shares rise as record highs on Wall Street, and policy easing in China help calm some jitters on global economic recovery. U.S. stock futures pointing to a muted open. Here at home, the PSEI slips to the 6,800 level after shedding more than 2%. Last week, will the slide continue? Rustin Mercado of China Bank Securities joins us for a market outlook. The Philippine peso also breaking into the 50 per dollar level. How will this affect the country's monetary policy outlook? We're going to be speaking with Philippine Central Bank Governor Benjamin Jokno later on the show. And billionaire Richard Branson completes his dream flight to the edge of space, opening doors for space tourism. We begin with the financial markets. Asian shares beginning the week with a relief rally as record highs on Wall Street from last Friday and policy easing in China help calm some of the recent jitters on global growth. Japan's Nikkei 225 jumping nearly 2% as machinery orders rose for the third straight month in May at 7.8%, easily beating a 2.6% expansion forecast. South Korea's KOSPI index also up 0.8% as the country's 10-day daily average exports grew 20%. Markets in Australia also in the green this morning. Now, over in the Middle East, Saudi Arabian stocks dropping for a fifth day on Sunday, its longest losing streak since January of last year. The benchmark Tadawul All-Share Index falling 1.2%, triggered by a pullback in reflation trade. Stocks also dropping in Dubai, while markets in Abu Dhabi bucked the downswing. Looking at some corporate stories from the region, Indonesia's state-owned pharmaceutical company Kimia Pharma set to start selling COVID-19 vaccines to the public this week. It will sell Sinopharm shots as Indonesia aims to speed up vaccinations as it grapples with a new surge of COVID-19 cases and new variants. And we're also looking at Microsoft, reportedly in talks to buy cybersecurity company Risk IQ in a bid to better protect its customers amid a rise in cyber attacks. Now, Microsoft will pay more than $500 million in cash for that deal. Now, over on Wall Street, U.S. stock futures pointing to a muted open when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. All the major indices flat, but in the green still, as investors gear up for the start of the second quarter earnings season. Now, remember, last Friday, U.S. stocks closed at record highs, recovering from a sell-off sparked by growth worries. Friday's rally lifted all the major indices into positive territory last week. But looking ahead, JP Morgan Chase, Goldman Sachs, and Pepsi will be kicking off the second quarter earnings season on Tuesday. Now, on the economic data front, investors will also be monitoring key readings on inflation coming out Tuesday, that's U.S. time, as well as June retail sales numbers. Now, tensions between the U.S. and China again heating up. Beijing condemning Washington's move to add 23 Chinese entities to its economic blacklist over various issues, including human rights abuses and military ties. China says the inclusion was a serious breach of international economic and trade rules and an unreasonable suppression of Chinese companies. It adds Beijing will take necessary measures to protect the interests of Chinese firms. The European Central Bank will change its policy guidance at its next meeting to reflect strategies to combat rising inflation. That's according to ECB President Christine Lagarde, who says the ECB's new strategy will allow it to tolerate inflation higher than its 2% goal when rates are near rock bottom. She adds this is meant to reassure investors that policy will not be tightened prematurely. The ECB's current guidance says it will buy bonds for as long as necessary and keep interest rates at their record low levels until the inflation outlook is stable. The ECB's next meeting is set on July 22. from the ECB joining us this morning to set the agenda for the week. We go now to the Philippine Central Bank Governor Ben Jokno. Governor Ben, thank you so much for joining us and happy Monday.
Happy Monday, Mimi.
Okay, so Gov, let's start with the peso. Where are we going with the peso? We do seem to be in a period in which the Philippine peso so far, which has been among the strongest in the region, has started to reverse a little bit. Last week, crossing the 50 pesos to the dollar psychological mark. Do you think that's going to stick? And what are markets trying to figure out here?
You mentioned a little bit. Yes, indeed. The BSP will continue to adopt a market-determined exchange rate policy, and so that's our approach. We deal with exchange rate volatility, looking at the demand and supply of foreign exchange. At the same time, our role is simply to smoothen the fluctuations and to make sure that the market conditions are orderly. Rather than steering the peso towards a particular level, stronger or weaker against other currencies. So that's our policy. And we note further that recent peso-dollar exchange rate movements have been in line with the forex movements of other currencies in the region in general, given the recent U.S. dollar strength.
Mm-hmm. And Governor, at what point will this start to be a concern for you?
Right now, it's not a concern. And we continue to monitor the behavior of the peso vis-a-vis not only our own, we have our own assumptions on the peso rate for the year, but we also monitor it in relation to our trading partners.
And so far at this level, Governor, it's still a win-win for Philippines when it comes to trade?
It's not a concern at the moment, yes. Okay. The short answer is no, it's not a concern.
Okay. Governor, let's now go to the bigger picture. The emerging COVID-19 variants, Delta variant, for example, Delta Plus, we've pinned our hopes on the ramp up of vaccination, the key part of everyone's recovery strategy all over the world, really. But now that we're seeing new variants that might overtake, you know, the vaccines that we currently have, does that concern you enough for you to revisit your recovery projections?
I'm very optimistic on the pace of our vaccination and the willingness of people to be vaccinated, unlike other countries where that really is a problem. For example, in the US, about half of them don't want to be vaccinated, and that's where the variants come in, right? At least in the Philippines, people are willing to be vaccinated. And we have, you know, there are many reasons why we should be optimistic. The vaccines are coming. And we have multiple sources of vaccines, unlike other countries where they have only one or two sources of vaccines. We have, if I remember right, 7, plus now the J&J is coming. And so with the willingness of Filipinos to be vaccinated and the coming in of multiple sources of vaccines, I think we'll be doing fine. So because really the solution to this economic problem is the vaccine. Because once we part of our population, we can start opening up the economy. And we have done that now, slowly opening up the economy. And that will bring about higher consumer and business confidence. And so at the same time, we are focused on our structural reforms, where we don't let the COVID pandemic get in the way of our structural reforms.
Governor, two things there. One, yes, the vaccines are coming, but now there are questions raised that the seeds of doubt have been planted whether the vaccines are effective against the new variants. Secondly, and in relation to that, a majority of our vaccines are now coming from Sinovac, from China, and some countries have raised concerns over the efficacy of these Chinese vaccines against the new variant. You're not at all concerned, sir.
No, we're now getting a lot of AstraZeneca. We're getting J&J and Pfizer is coming. You know, the statistics in the U.S. is very telling. 95% of those who are now infected have not been vaccinated. So as long as we get our focus on the right track and we keep on vaccinating our people, and the pace of vaccination is increasing from 250,000 daily to the idea is to have it to ramp up to about 500,000 daily. Okay.
Okay. Let's look at what the central banks are doing, sir. Investors now seem to be slowly starting to price in divergence from central banks. You guys seem to be ready to do your own thing, not necessarily follow the Fed. Do you think so, sir? Are you ready to walk down a different rate path? And how, if ever yes, how do you think that will impact assets across the board?
The Philippines is now very different from where it was, say, 20 years ago or even earlier. I've seen so many crises in my life. I mention this all the time. And whenever there's a crisis, we run out of dollars, okay? Because we have a huge foreign debt. And as a result, we have to adjust our interest rates to stem the flow of the outflow of dollars. That's not the case anymore. We have a hefty gross international reserves, and we have multiple sources of foreign exchange coming in. We have the OFW remittances, we have the BPO receipts, and the foreign direct investments are continue to come in. So I'm not worried about what is called the rate of the Fed's interest rates going up. And that will cause a lot of problems, admittedly, for other emerging economies, but not for the Philippines.
So you're not under pressure, sir, because a lot of the analysts we talk to say, when the Fed starts to raise, we're going to have to follow whatever happens. You
Now,
don't think so?
that's true for, as I said, other emerging economies, which right now have a huge debt to GDP ratio. And so they'll be under a lot of pressure under that kind of situation, not the Philippines. Our debt to GDP ratio, even after the massive borrowing for the COVID, is around 60%. And that is still significantly lower than what I call sustainable rate of borrowing for the Philippines.
So, sir, you think maybe for the if you look past the next 6 to 12 months, are you seeing any changes, major changes in your policy?
We are the BSP, as I always say, is data dependent, and we look at international developments, we look at the local developments, and so I'm comfortable that we'll continue to be supportive of the economy, given that the economy is still at its nascent recovery phase. I think we'll see a big positive for the second quarter. There will be a strong second half of the year. And so let's see from there whether we will make some adjustments in our policy.
Okay. Final question, Governor. We're back to the global dirty money watchdogs gray list, like Haiti, Malta, and South Sudan. Not exactly the best company to have, but
Yes.
where do you think did we slip? And what's being done now?
No, because the evaluation of the Philippines is based not only on the technical compliance, but on effectiveness compliance. We have to demonstrate effective implementation of the things we have done. And we've done a lot. And in fact, there's no more, I think, no more actions on the part of Congress that we need. It's to demonstrate effective compliance in some 18 action items. And that's, if I remember right, they started from 80, 80, and now it's down to 18 international cooperative review group action plan items. And unfortunately, some of these items are easy to comply with, others are more difficult. And they've given us until January of 2023, some 18 months to comply with some of these action plans. And right now, we are under enhanced monitoring or gray list. That's not bad, as long as we're given, as I said, 18 months to comply with it. And so, with that, as I said, there's a varying degree of difficulty on how to comply. I'll give you an example of what's what I consider to be easy. For example, item number 18. There are 18 action items. Number 18 is easy to me. It says demonstrate that supervisors undertake risk-based, or not rather, issue a step-by-step guidance by delisting and freezing procedures and publish it widely. That's to me, that could be complied with before the end of the year easily. Right, but there are some more difficult.
What's the items. Difficult one, sir?
I'll give you an example of a difficult one. Item number 14, I think it says, or rather, item number 7, demonstrate an increase in investigations and prosecutions in accordance with Philippine risk profile, including crimes with transnational element and or foreign proceeds, and using formal and informal international cooperation when necessary. Okay, you know, the wild card here, why it's 18 months, is because there is an intervening election next year.
So
we could have complied with this within say 1 year, but because of the intervening election, we expect some changes in the officials of what you call the law enforcement agencies, like the PNP, the FBI, the NBI, and the Bancor, for example, and even SEC. So we provided for that. So in the event that there is a change in leadership, then we can still meet the deadline. What makes a lot of difference is if we don't meet the deadline by January 2023. So we have to demonstrate the effectiveness, no longer compliance. Compliance of legislation, et cetera, that's done. It's compliance.
Okay. Governor, for anyone who's just reading the headline about this story, they're probably asking, now that the Philippines was re-included in the gray list, is it safe to assume that there were money laundering and terrorist financing activities that happened during the pandemic? Would that be a safe assumption, sir?
No, it's always been. There's always been such incidents, and we continue to monitor them. So
Was there an increase in such incidences?
We don't know that, whether there's an increase, but one reform that I have introduced as chairman of the anti-money laundering is that we are applying artificial intelligence, okay? AI. We're acquiring such capability, because it's hard to monitor all this. As you know, every time you deposit more than ₱500,000, that's supposed to be reported to us. And so, but at the same time, even if it's less than ₱500,000, if there's a pattern, that is also reported. But you know, if you can't do that manually. It has to be through an artificial intelligence mechanism. So we are upgrading our technology, and we are hiring more people to really monitor all these events.
Okay. So, Governor, are you confident you're going to meet the 2023 deadline to meet the 18
actions? I'm very confident. We're doing it. We're meeting almost every week, and we are coordinating closely with other law enforcement agencies. You know, this is an all of nation approach, because we cannot do it by ourselves. Okay, so we're coordinating with the National Bureau of Investigation, the PNP, the PAGBOR, and right now the real estate. We also have to monitor the real estate, and of course Securities and Exchange Commission. And this is actually coordinated by a body which was created, and the chairman of this is the executive secretary himself, and I'm the vice chair of this body.
Okay, Governor, you're a very, very busy man. Always have been, and I think for the next few months. Thank you, sir, for joining us this morning. Have a great week ahead, and do stay safe.
Stay safe too.
And that was Governor Ben Jokna of the Philippine Central Bank. Moving on now to other stories, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today. Monday, the Philippines will come out with its June foreign exchange reserves. The central bank's dollar reserves dipped to $106.97 billion in May as the government withdrew currency to use for debt repayments. Meanwhile, Malaysia will report its retail sales numbers for May. Retail trade in Malaysia surged 56.4% in April. It was the second straight month of increase and the strongest growth since the series began in 2013 amid a further economic recovery from the pandemic and, of course, a low base effect from last year. We also will monitor India, which is set to release its inflation print for June. India's consumer price index went up to 6.3% in May. That is the highest in 6 months, as higher global commodity prices weighed. Richard Branson beats fellow billionaire Jeff Bezos in the space race. Now, Branson and three other members of Virgin Galactic's VSS Unity earned their wings on Sunday after a successful flight to the edge of space. Branson is hoping to usher in an era of space tourism with Virgin Galactic. The company he founded in 2004 is poised to begin commercial operations by next year.
I was once a kid with a dream, looking up to the stars. And now I'm an adult in a spaceship looking back to our beautiful Earth. You know, as you go into space, the views are breathtaking. I mean, there's no question we are so lucky to have this planet that we all live on. And that's what Virgin Orbit, our other space company that had a tremendous success last week, and Virgin Galactic, you know, we've got to all be doing everything we can to help this incredible planet we live on. I will devote the rest of my life doing that, and I think other people who go to space with us will devote the rest of their lives doing that.
Virgin Galactic plans to resume ticket sales after its test flights with fares of around, $250,000. That's over 10 million pesos per seat. The company's shares have so far doubled this year, lifting its value to almost $12 billion. Now, Branson's fellow space tourism pioneers are congratulating the British billionaire for Virgin Galactic's historic feat. On Instagram, Amazon founder Jeff Bezos said he cannot wait to join the club. Bezos plans a similar trip to the edge of space in 9 days aboard a rocket from his own company, Blue Origin. SpaceX boss Elon Musk also tweeting his congratulations. Musk was among the guests during the launch of Branson's space flight. The finance ministers of the world's 20 largest economies back a historic deal to overhaul global corporate tax rules. But as this report tells us, that move was met with protests. Take a look.
Protesters from all over Italy rallied in Venice as the G20 summit continued on Saturday. It's the first face-to-face meeting between finance ministers of the world's 20 largest economies since the global health crisis began. With corporate tax reform at the top of the agenda, a landmark proposal to stop multinational companies from shifting profits to low tax havens was endorsed. That would pave the way for G20 leaders to finalize a new global minimum corporate tax rate of 15% at a Rome summit in October.
The international tax deal protects the free, open economic order that is crucial for investment and growth. And at the same time, it's welcome news for middle and working class people around the world.
Demonstrators near the canals of Venice, however, were not convinced.
They are there discussing and taking decisions that concern everybody in the world, and they're not listening to the people. And so we are here to tell them that they cannot, 20 people, discuss something that concerns everybody.
Setting a tax floor is intended to stop multinationals from setting up shop in countries with the lowest tax rate. It would change the way that companies like Amazon and Google are taxed, basing it partly on where they sell products and services rather than on the location of their headquarters. The move could also recoup hundreds of billions of dollars for public treasuries under strain during the current crisis. British Finance Minister Rishi Sunak.
This agreement ensures that our tax system is fit for the digital age and crucially that the right companies pay the right tax in the right places.
A final statement from the summit said that the global economic outlook saw improvement since talks in April. However, it also warned that recovery could be hampered by an upsurge in fast-spreading variants such as Delta and inequitable distribution of vaccinations globally. Among some of the wealthiest countries, over two-thirds of citizens have had at least one shot of vaccine, but that figure falls well below 5% for many African nations.
U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen also urging G20 finance chiefs to increase their support for global COVID-19 vaccination efforts. That's as she expressed concern about new and fast-spreading coronavirus variants, which are now threatening the world's recovery.
We are a connected global economy. What happens in any part of the world affects all other countries. We therefore recognize the importance of working together to speed the process of vaccination and have the goal of wanting to vaccinate 70% of the world's population next year. To that end, the United States has pledged to share 580 million vaccine doses. And I strongly urge my G20 counterparts to step up their support.
We are taking a quick break. Coming up, where to next for the Philippine Stock Exchange Index after dropping back to the 6,800 level? We did fall 2.4% last week. Are we going to gain back that ground this week? It's going to be a data light week. What's going to move the needle? Restine Mercado of China Bank Securities joins us for some perspective when Market Edge returns.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Welcome back. You're still watching Market Edge. The headlines: Asian shares rising as record highs on Wall Street and policy easing in China help calm some jitters on global economic recovery. U.S. stock futures pointing to a muted open. Here at home, the PSEI slipped back to 6,800 level last Friday after shedding more than 2% last week. Will the slide continue? Not exactly, but it is opening flat to the upside. The index opening higher by 3 points, less than a tenth of 1%. We're now at 68.38 in the first minute of trade for the day and for the week. Rustine Mercado of China Bank Securities joins us for a market outlook. And billionaire Richard Branson completing his flight to the edge of space, opening doors for space tourism. The Philippine Stock Exchange has kicked off trading. Right now it's at 68.45, as I mentioned earlier. Wow, it is widening those gains. In the first minute of trade, we're now up 10 points. That's a tenth of 1%. Joining us now for his take on the markets, Rustine Mercado of China Bank Securities. Hi, Rustine. Great to have you this morning.
Hi, Mimi. Thanks for having me this morning.
Okay, so Rustine, tell us about where we are right now. We've been fluctuating the past couple of days, but holding up on very thin volumes. What comes next?
Well, I mean, in the immediate term, we might see a bounce today following the recovery off of the 6770 support last Friday. Over the medium term, of course, we're heading deeper into consolidation territory after last week's steep descent. So Friday's strong close may translate into that recovery rally that hopefully we'll see today. But we expect the 7,100 resistance to be an ironclad level for now. But for those thinking, if we'll be revisiting the 6,000 levels anytime soon, probably not. Why? Because prospects remain much better now than where we were back in May. Vaccination rates, despite being sluggish, continue to ramp up. Earnings prospects for companies are also expected to improve with higher vaccination rates. So it's very normal for the market to take pause and consolidate after the run it's had. I mean, like, we've been up around 14% since late May, right? So I think this is just part of a healthy uptrend.
Healthy uptrend there. But you did mention that the prospects seem brighter this time around, but you've got the new COVID-19 variants. Do you think that the new variants, the emerging variants, Delta, Delta Plus, Gamma, do they warrant a repricing of assets and expectations? Because over the weekend, you've got BlackRock, for example, saying we are grappling with a, quote, potentially unusually wide range of outcomes at this point. Do you think it's time to reprice?
Well, I think definitely. It's an evolving risk, obviously, that will affect outlook. And I don't think that the market has, local market at least, has really priced that in, given that we've been touching the 7,100 levels last week, right? So it's likely going to be a factor in how low the consolidation pullback is going to go. Hopefully, we don't see levels below 6,500. But really, if you zoom out and take a look at other ASEAN countries where infection rates have risen because of these variants, you don't really see a market decline in prices via their peaks in early January, right? So even as we try to price in those risks, it may not really result in a steep decline. So in terms of valuations, as you mentioned, I think EMs, emerging markets, still have windfall, including us, of course, especially as valuations continue to be stretched in developed markets. So the US, it's continuing to go up, right? So at some point, return prospects there will level off and fund flows will search for deep value plays, which might benefit EMs. So more than this, of course, election year is coming up, right? So hopefully this also helps drive domestic demand.
Okay, everybody has been talking about that developed markets like the US or Europe are now looking pretty stretched and that eventually the money will look for, you know, better yields where value is still good, like emerging markets. But we haven't really seen that materialize. Do you have a timeline for when you expect the big money to come rushing back into EMs because we're cheap? We're cheap enough.
Well, I think we're going to see more of that over the early months of 2022. Hopefully, we see some positioning towards the tail end of 2021. But then again, you see the EMs have the most they're the most exposed to these new variants, right? So I think it's still a wait and see approach, seeing how that evolves in terms of the domestic pandemic situation. And then hopefully we see that leveling off in returns in the US somewhere towards the end of the year.
Okay, Rusty, let's now go over some interesting corporate stories. For those who are active on Facebook, you probably came across this post from Mr. Ramon Ang of the San Miguel Group. He posted this, I think, over the weekend, where he did say that San Miguel, its power unit at least, is dropping new coal power projects to focus more on renewable energy. How strong of a statement is this from one of the biggest conglomerates, the most influential conglomerates in the Philippines? Do you think this is, you know, a sign that finally RE is going mainstream?
Well, obviously, I think this is a good development. As we all know, there's a moratorium on new coal power plants. So it comes with little surprise that the government and obviously energy firms are shifting away from coal power or other non-renewable source of energy and pivoting towards renewable energy. So, of course, the main challenge right now is to fill in the projected demand with upcoming supply. But hopefully this translates to an enrichment in government policy framework towards renewables. So we're on the lookout for that.
Okay, how about this one? NLEX Corporation, this is, of course, part of the Metro Pacific Group. They say they've completed pavement repairs of over 140,000 square meters of NLEX and SCTech. So this is good news for motorists. And they're now undertaking rehab work for the Meycauayan Bridge and Bigaa Bridge in Bulacan. The infra play, are they looking attractive at this point?
I think infra is still strong. I mean, like, obviously we're coming into an election year, so I mean that might factor in a bit towards that. But on the balance of things, it's a welcome development, right? With the infrastructure spending still strong, you're seeing mobility restrictions ease. So all of these roadworks and all of these other infrastructure works will really have a good positive impact when we do finally bounce back into going out of our homes, hopefully over the near future.
In the near future, we all hope that's going to be end of this year by Christmas or maybe next year. Yeah, how about hopefully. This one? From the Sugar Regulatory Authority, they're saying that sugar production for the month of June came in flat at 2.134 million metric tons. While it is flat, this is actually better than expected because they were expecting a short drop. We've got several listed sugar companies at the exchange. How are they looking at this point? Do you think this is going to be a good bet? I mean, commodities have been on a roll this year. Some are even calling it a commodity super cycle. So is this boom in commodities and commodity prices reflected in the performance of these listed sugar shares at the Philippine Stock Exchange?
Well, I think that really is specific to each company, right? So I think the key takeaway from the data from the SRA is, of course, that demand grows year in year. Inflationary concerns are obviously still there, so demand for refined sugar is up, but production is down, right? So I think this is a story that we've been hearing throughout all commodities. So that will lead into concerns about inflation, which, again, favorite word is transitory, right? So if you look at the inflation print for June, price increases in sugar, just marginal, right? So I think not too much of a concern in terms of inflation at this point.
Okay, and we have this, some bit of good news to start the week. Mega World says it has completed the vaccination of 95% of its office-based employees, mostly in Metro Manila. And they're actually looking to also start vaccinating and ramping up the inoculation for their hotel and mall frontliners. So we've been seeing all these good news, how these private companies are really taking up the cudgels to vaccinate their employees.
Well, that's a very good sign, right? I mean, part of all of this, part of the public vaccination drive is really getting companies back into full motion, right? So hopefully this that becomes more widespread. And I think our private companies are really doing that, getting things to a new normal, at least, right, for their employees. So I think that's a really good sign that there are better prospects to come.
Yeah, nobody's safe until everyone is safe. That's what they're saying about COVID-19. Let's go to an interesting foreign story on a lighter note. The wedding industry, at least in the U.S., Rustine, seems to be rebounding from the pandemic, with engagement ring sales spiking for the month of April and May. With people not spending much on travel yet, they seem to be spending a lot on the rock. Are there any businesses here that are also tied to weddings and engagements that could see a boom soon? Can you think of a listed company here? I'm thinking the hotels. The hotels could be one, you know.
Yeah. Well, I think, yeah, definitely hotels. But I mean, like, honestly, at this point, we still have mobility restrictions here, right? Mm. Compared to the US, those have been largely scaled back. So again, this comes as no surprise, right? A lot of people put their big plans on hold for a year and a half, right? So, and then it comes as no surprise in the US because obviously you have strong demand, you have a tinge of revenge spending there amid strong fiscal stimulus and savings. So hopefully we do get to see that here as well. So again, we all go that back to the main risk is inflation, right? So hopefully the transitory narrative proves to be true, and hopefully that doesn't translate into hawkish policy action from the Federal Reserve and of course the BSP.
Okay, I just wanted to bring this in. We have the peso. The peso has been weakening, and it crossed last week the psychological 50 to the dollar handle. Today, it actually opened slightly stronger, 50.05 against the U.S. dollar from the previous close last Friday of 50.08. Rustine, you've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us, just describe. We're going to leave it to our investor viewers to guess what this is. So what is it that you're liking today?
Well, this is one of the more battered retail stocks in the market over the past few months, but it looks like the tides are finally turning in its favor with improving prospects amid recovering consumer demand, peaking valuations in some index issues, and fund flows favoring laggards. So there's a good chance that this issue may push higher over the next couple of weeks. Moreover, one of its business-to-business e-commerce investments completed another round of fundraising, which totaled around $30 million or roughly 1.5 billion pesos. So given the firm's improving prospects, we may see more brisk fund flows into the stock. Technical upside is around 14% over the next several weeks. So support is at 54. Immediate resistance is at 57.50, but we're eyeing a recovery up to 63 pesos.
63 pesos recovery price, what timetable? 6-12 months?
No, probably in the next 1-2 months, hopefully. We do get
wow,
to see that.
That is fast. Okay, yeah. We're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Rustine, thank you so much for joining us. Have a great week ahead.
Thank you for having me. Have a great week ahead, Mimi.
Okay, just before we go to the next story, just wanted to update you guys. The PSEI widening the gains. Wow, the index now up 0.4%, 28 points, 68.62. The question is, can we climb back to the 6,900 level and retest 7,000 again? We're going to find out. We've got the rest of the week to watch this index move. In the meantime, let's go through the top headlines from major business papers. From Business World, the Philippine government further tightens its anti-money laundering rules, particularly in monitoring real estate transaction following the country's inclusion in the Financial Action Task Force's gray list. Under the new guidelines, real estate brokers and developers are told to watch out for transactions where there is certainty or a sign the parties seem to be hiding the identity of the real customer buying the property. The BSP governor just spoke about this earlier in the program. He did say we have 18 months or until January 2023 to meet 18 action points from FTAF to be able to be removed from the gray list, and he's confident we can do it. From Business Mirror, data from Lichu Property Consultants show demand for office spaces here in the Philippines grew during the second quarter of the year, despite the pandemic, as investor sentiment continues to improve. And from the Wall Street Journal, Dial Capital is nearing a deal to make an investment in the NBA team Sacramento Kings. The deal, which could be announced as soon as this week, would give the investment firm a nearly 5% stake in the team at a valuation of $1.5 billion. Guest is a Croatian tech firm that makes customer service chatbots. Let's all welcome Velid Begovic, the sales director at InfoBip Asia Pacific. Hi, Velid. Thank you so much for joining us live from Hong Kong. Is this Hong Kong?
Yes. Thank you, Michelle. Good to be here.
Great to have you finally. So I guess I want to start with, you know, as a global cloud communications company, you essentially help firms like Uber and Microsoft manage communications with their clients through text message services and chatbots. How's the Asian market though? I know the parent global Infobip reported a 57% jump in sales in the first quarter, but if you look at Asia, how strong is Asia and of course the Philippines?
Of course, Michelle. So Infobip is a global cloud communication company operating out of 65 offices globally. Infobip, when we first landed in Asia, we quickly found out that Philippines was going to be one of our key home markets here as well. Today, when we look at the region, it's one of our key regions driving much of the growth because, of course, the sheer number of people that need these kind of communication services in the region. Infobip in Philippines is our largest office, actually, in Infobip Asia Pacific, but it's both servicing the local market needs as well as serving as a regional excellence hub. And what we do at the basic context is you know, we help businesses build connected experiences across all points of their customer journey. It's not just the big businesses like Uber or Facebook, but also like small and medium and any range of businesses. By providing them a programmable software as a service solutions, we onboard them onto an omni-channel platform cloud that enables them to communicate users for all kind of purposes, whether it be engagement, automation, or customer service.
And Velid, this is done through social media platforms, am I right? Perhaps Twitter or Facebook or Instagram. Is this correct?
Yes, correct. Mm-hmm. It can be done through the social media platforms, or it can be done through a range of communication channels. So when you think about it, you know, the pandemic really accelerated the digital transformation here in Asia Pacific and globally. And what happened is quickly many businesses realized that utilizing a communication platform became a vital part of the strategy for them to enable their business continuity and engagement with their users. From our perspective, the way we see this, we want to expand the number of channels in order to provide, you know, the most, the widest touch points available. We did so by acquiring a leading SMS firewall company globally called ANA. As they cooperate with many telcos around the world, this helps us really, you know, fundamentally strengthen our offering in the legacy type of channels as well, such as text and voice. So it's not just the social media as well. But in order to really build like a rich customer experience, on top of that, we partnered with Google for their business messaging to enable rich rich messaging communications. And most recently, of course, in the sense of adding the social media, we integrated the Instagram Messenger, which we believe to be a really key part for many enterprises in their customer communication needs.
Velid, are there trends? Does the Philippine market, for example, have a unique personality when it comes to doing customer service on social media platforms or other platforms or channels as compared to other markets? I mean, I personally see a lot of hate messages going around Twitter of angry telco or utility clients, and they're just so mad.
Yeah. Well, effectively, you know, we published a report last year called The Year of Disruption, in which we touched a lot of bases on this context of how to do customer service within the new landscape. And yes, you're right, you know, Philippines market, as well as many Asian Pacific markets, really have their specificities. And that comes across primarily in the type of channels where the users like to, you know, communicate. What we observed from the Philippines market, for example, is we are seeing channels such as email and social media being the primary drivers of customer engagement when it comes to customer service. But of course, the traditional channels such as calling the hotlines still remain relevant. Where we are seeing the largest growth is of course, the conversational channels, one of them being very specific to the Philippine market, namely this is Viber. So, you know, this kind of inspires also our solution building. while Viber is not necessarily a communication channel with any prevalence in other Asia-Pacific markets, we still devote a lot of resources and partnership with Rakuten in order to bring in this specific channel in order to really, you know, make a distinction and enable the businesses mm-hmm. to really be where their users are.
Velid, how do you personalize or try to personalize these conversations with customers and make them more palatable? Because every time I make a complaint, for example, over Facebook or Twitter, I always get dismayed when I realize it's a chatbot answering me. How do you guys make this more palatable, more conversational, more personalized, more effective in answering questions?
Well, to answer that question, you know, from a very standpoint, when we design our solution for this purpose, we actually called it conversations. So we can recognize the obvious point that today's users are very liberal in the choice of their medium of where they decide to engage with their respective businesses. Mm-hmm. And what we are seeing on the other hand is that businesses are largely playing catch up with this kind of behavior. While the users, you know, are able to utilize any kind of channels and somewhat be unpredictable in this sense, the businesses need to be able to sharply respond to this. So our solution actually takes this insight precisely, you know, at the core of its development. The way we enable businesses to really personalize their messaging in such instances is it starts from a very simple standpoint. We unify all the conversations, irrelevant of what channel or medium they're coming from, in a one unified space where the agent would be provided with a much needed context on how to essentially respond in such, you know, let's put it like a time critical engagement from the end user. It could be, mm-hmm. you know, like a make it or break it kind of point for that user to continue using this company services. But moreover, they can actually utilize these kind of behaviors and these kind of data to customize and build proactively engagement mm-hmm. campaigns that are designed around user behavior and around their like touch points throughout the digital journey.
Okay. Velid, I'm very curious, to companies that utilize your service, what kind of cost savings are they benefiting from?
Okay. Naturally, I mean, our solutions are cloud-based first. We are a cloud-based company, and we believe this to be a key distinction that essentially eliminates the business's requirement, you know, for heavy upfront investment in infrastructure or other OPEX investment mm-hmm. requirements. This makes our solution scalable. It makes it available for all range of businesses and size. Irrelevant of, you know, their actual like you know, capacity to a budget or through the actual need for communication. As such, our payment, you know, and commercial models are also modular and scalable to the businesses. Now, of course, we do believe that the essence our business businesses are targeting, you know, their user engagement and user retention as, you know, a preventive strategy, of course, in order to really maximize on having their users. And by doing so, you know, our solutions are targeting the business's bottom line as well. The ROI of implementing such solutions will, of course, be contingent on the type of strategies that the companies will deploy. But at the end of the day, Michelle, I believe that implementation of such solutions is a cost-saving strategy in the long run.
Okay, on that note, Velid Begovic, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Look forward to having you back on the show.
Thank you, Michelle.
Okay, now before we go, for those who try to guess your blind item, this is the stock pick of Rastine Mercado, one of the more battered retail stocks in the market over the past months. But it looks like, he says, the tides are finally turning in its favor. One of its business-to-business e-commerce investments recently completed another round of fundraising, which totaled $30 million, or roughly 1.5 billion pesos. Looking at the technicals, you're looking at an upside of 14% over the next several weeks. Support at 54, immediate resistance resistance at 57.50, but he's actually seeing a recovery to around 63 pesos a piece in the next 1 to 2 months. This stock is Robinson's Retail Holdings, RRHI. Do let us know if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. And that is it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. You can listen to our interviews again on the ANC Market Edge podcast, available now on Spotify. You can also watch highlights, recaps, exclusive content of our shows online. Don't forget, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
At a time when we are gripped by fear, we are inspired by your courage. At a time when we are in dire need of hope, we look up to your sense of duty and compassion. At a time when the default reaction is self-preservation, you put the needs of the sick above your own. All those who are in the front lines of this pandemic, thank you.
Returns to the streets of Hong Kong.